November 28, 2015. So how did we get here? Aside from a lifelong battle with endometriosis and fibroid tumors, neither of which are life-threatening or linked to cancer in any way, I'm pretty darn healthy. My energy levels have always been average. I've explored different diets, but my weight has held steady for most of my adulthood. In my non-medical opinion, all that spells a healthy woman in her late 20s. On top of all that, every health screening I've had has been positive, telling me I'm in great shape across all the common blood tests and various vital signs. Then last weekend happened. Mike, he's the heroic husband that will feature prominently in this blog, and I were in Illinois with my family for Thanksgiving when I started to feel a nagging pain in my right side. When we went to urgent care on Monday to get checked out for peace of mind, we were told to go to the ER for a CT scan because they can't do them at urgent care. Once at the ER, the doctor ordered a CT scan, fully expecting to find something awry with my appendix or gallbladder. Instead, the lovely doctor gently informed us of the 9-centimeter mass on my liver. She then recommended that we pick a hospital in St. Louis to head to next. As we sat discussing our options, we joked about not even entertaining the cancer possibility. What 28-year-old gets diagnosed with liver cancer? Once at Barnes Hospital, they set me up on the liver floor. The first order was blood tests, and then an MRI to confirm. At this point, with nothing but a grainy CT scan to go by, they thought the tumor might be a benign growth caused by my years of hormone distribution via birth control / recent fertility treatments. I couldn't eat anything, so we lounged. Mom, Dad, Mike, and I made sure they had ESPN so we could catch the Bills game that night. The last minute multiple biopsy request didn't even clue me in, but to be fair, my rose-colored glasses are pretty powerful, and I must have assumed that biopsying a liver mass is par for the course. That evening, around 5 o'clock, the priest from my childhood church and our deacon, both close family friends, popped in for a visit. And we sat in a big circle to chat. Me, Mike, Mom, Dad, my brother Luke, Father, and Deacon Linus. It was with this amazing support group around me that I got the news. Cholangiocarcinoma. Liver cancer. Rare, aggressive, but hopefully treatable. The doctor told us that he is 90% certain, and he would not even bring this up if he were any less certain. I asked the few questions that entered into my scattered brain, then the room fell silent as we all processed the news. There were some tears, and I had some trouble looking my loved ones in the eye. 28 years old, and liver cancer. December 26, 2015. Due to circumstances beyond our control, we did not get Christmas cards out this year. Actually, you know what? That's not entirely true. There was time, and we had chances. I even brought them with me to the hospital one day to work on them. But we chose other things, so we won't be blaming Tim for my lack of Christmas card diligence. In lieu of a physical card this year, this post will serve as a distant second best thing. We had two beautiful days of Christmas cheer full of all the wonderful things that remind us of how blessed we are. I am so grateful for the outpouring of love, and I am praying for everyone who is praying for us. So my Christmas wish is that you all have a blessed holidays filled with love, laughter, peace, and fun. And finally, we have a recording of Dad and I singing together. 2 months ago, I asked Dad if he would sing with me at my church, and he agreed. I sent him music, we made plans to practice, then Tim appeared, and everything turned topsy-turvy. And Thursday night was the big performance. I was tired, a little nauseous, and my sinuses were still taunting me. Despite everything, though, I got to sing with my dad. May 25th, 2016. With Mom in attendance, today's chemo was reminiscent of the early chemos. Mom, Mike, and I left at 5:15 to be at Strong by 7:30 for a blood draw, followed by an appointment with Dr. H. 6 months into this and I'm still figuring out what works. This time I sent my list of questions in advance. Dr. H came in prepared to talk about my items, which started with the question around how long we think chemo will go. Diving right in, he basically led with some surprising news. In his professional opinion, we are about done with chemo. He dropped the surprising bomb on us that if my counts were bad today, it was going to be his recommendation that we'd be done altogether. So after a meeting with Dr. H, we headed back for infusion as we tried to wrap our heads around a much earlier end to the chemo leg of this journey. What a crazy whole new world this opens up. One I hadn't even begun to consider. Mike and I were talking about just this when he mentioned the word normal, which understandably gave me pause. Now there was a new thought I hadn't gotten to yet. At what point will I no longer think about cancer on and off throughout every day? Even still, maybe, just maybe, there will come a day cancer is in the rearview mirror.
September 28th, 2017. With everything going on in our world, I didn't have much time to fret about this round of scans. I had the usual scan anxiety, and at one point while on a break during my workday, I looked up each of my genetic alterations on clinicaltrials.gov, just in case. But aside from a few panicked moments, I just didn't have the downtime to obsess. By the time we were sitting in the exam room waiting for Dr. H, I was a basket of nerves. I went over for about the 30th time what plans A, B, and C would be if the cancer was back. Then forced a smile as Dr. H came into the room and opened with a statement around how he didn't see anything concerning in the scans, but we need to wait for the radiologist's report to be sure. The standard wave of relief washed over me, tension eased down and out of my back, and we went through the usual business of exchanging pleasantries and me sharing with Dr. H things I had heard from other patients in my group. I mentioned the changes on the farm, the planned renovation of the house, and fostering. He said that sounded entirely reasonable, and he could understand why I was increasingly anxious with the recent scans. Finally, he asked if I wanted to see the scans before I left. I joked about my over rather than under communication preferences as I sidled up next to him at the computer to look at the images over his left shoulder. Just as he was opening the first file, a message popped up, and he said something to the effect of, "Ah, the CT results." He opened them, and before he could say anything, I read the words, "Concerning for metastatic disease." I can only think of one other time where I've been so completely blindsided by news like this before, and that was the Friday before my liver resection. Not even my diagnosis took the wind out of me quite like this moment. What was most shocking about the word metastases was that it struck me that we weren't talking about my liver. We're talking about my lungs. There's something wrong in my lungs. Dr. H turned to me, an anguished expression on his face, and he began to apologize as his cell phone rang and he said it was the radiologist. I won't rehash the remainder of the visit, other than to say that the mood was very much altered, and I'm now waiting for a PET scan, a meeting with my surgeon, and a consult with a thoracic surgeon. Lung mets is common in cholangiocarcinoma. It's also a harbinger of some of the worst news a patient can hear. Terminal. There's no known cure for metastatic cholangiocarcinoma that has spread to the lungs if it cannot be removed entirely. Mike and I came home yesterday evening and he headed straight out to work. I sat inside attempting to muscle my way through an episode of Law & Order SVU that had precisely zero of my attention when Mike popped in for dinner. Before I knew it, I had thrown an old sweatshirt over my nice workout shirt and tights, was in the barn boots, and was walking across the street with Mike to hang out with him while he worked. I can't say if it was the endorphins or the ever-humbling experience of being covered in cow feces, but I soon felt considerably better, so I finished my task, headed back into the house, and puttered around doing little chores that had been piling up in our absence. I'm certain the next 2 weeks will have moments of joy, fear, and intense anxiety, but I can't control what's going on in my body, so I'm trying to choose to just enjoy life until the PET scan that will help point us in the direction of which action we should take.
April 19th, 2018. A few weeks before my lung surgery in February, Mike and I sat down to have a serious conversation around what life would look like if my cancer had indeed returned. We contemplated a life of endless chemo, worsening side effects, low blood counts, financial stress, juggling work with treatment, traveling for clinical trials, game plans for emergencies, and so much more. It was an admittedly dark conversation, but from the start, I have found comfort in planning, and that means accounting for the sunny days as well as the stormy ones. As we pondered, it occurred to me that my quality of life had the potential to change irrevocably. There are things I enjoy that I would like to do as much as possible before I can do them no more. When I voiced this to Mike, he asked if there was anywhere I wanted to travel, and I considered all the corners of the world I wanted to see. We started to bounce ideas off of each other, making a list of things we wanted to see. No destination was too extravagant or remote. The sky was our limit. We daydreamed about beaches in the Pacific and colorful Indian markets. But in each scenario, my cancer elbowed into the conversation. It would be difficult and potentially dangerous to wander so far from home if I was mid-chemo and immunocompromised. There is so much I haven't seen here in the States, and I would especially love to get some hiking in before my body decides I'm not fit for those adventures anymore. That was it then. We would explore the US. Then we just had to decide what, where, when, how, you know, all the details. In June, Mike and I will be taking a break from everything, including work and chemo, to pack into a rented minivan and see as many national parks as possible. If it weren't for the help of a growing group of people, this trip simply would not be possible. And I know that gratitude will be in my heart every day of this incredible venture.
February 28th, 2019. About a week ago, Mike and I crossed paths in our living room, and he unexpectedly took me into his arms to dip me into a romantic kiss. For anyone who has never been kissed like that, first, go out and find someone to kiss you like that. And second, there are logistical considerations. For example, the one doing the dipping should put a leg out so that the dippee can lean into their thigh. The dippee is also involved in the maneuver, as it would end badly if that person did not move the right way and tighten their core to maintain the equilibrium and not put their full weight into the dipper's arms. As Mike lowered me against his thigh, I leaned back, delighted, before the pain hit, and I cried out. He pulled me straight back into his chest, concern in his eyes, and I explained that the twist and tightening of abdominal muscles had caused pain to shoot out from under my right ribs. As much as I wanted to lose myself in that sweet gesture, the moment was lost to that pain and the uneasy acknowledgement that I'm growing more symptomatic. For over 3 years now, I've lived life from scan to scan, sneaking cures to cancer into my daydreams. Sometimes I pretend there is a grand governmental discovery that removes this burden from all sufferers. In moments of imaginary selfishness, I dream that something specific happens, in my case, a miracle, a remarkable response to treatment. I'm not sure if any of this is healthy or even normal, but unfortunately these glimpses of life after cancer, imaginings of being well and living into my 80s, can leave me feeling terribly hollow when I set fantasy aside and read a radiologist's report, or break my husband's kiss due to pain radiating from where the largest cluster of tumors is pressing against my ribs.
In moments of weakness, anger creeps in, but the target is one you might not expect. I'm not mad at my cancer, God, science, the medical industry, or even myself. Instead, my fists clench as I mentally focus on the false prince that haunts these difficult days. Hope.
Thank you.
Yay!
Yay! All right, I'm done now.
Okay, yeah, you did very well. Wow. Ladies and gentlemen,
August 7th, 2019, at 12:15 a.m., Cait passed away. She was surrounded by her loved ones and did not pass alone. We all knew this day was coming, but it doesn't make the hurt, the loss, any less. While I am no Cait, when it comes to writing, I wanted to say a few words about what Cait has left with me. When I'm thinking about Cait, I think I can sum it up into three words: morality, empathy, and logic. She was overflowing with these traits, and they were a big part of the reason she has meant so much to so many, and everything to me. I would like to say some of these traits have rubbed off on me a little, and I'm going to boil it down to a phrase that I will use for the rest of my life. What would Cait do? Whenever there is a problem I'm dealing with or situation that seems impossible, I will utter the phrase, "What would Cait do?" and try to channel some of her amazing morality, empathy, and logic. I hope you all will do the same. Her loving husband, Mike.
Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak?
No.
Encore!
We're done.
No more.
We got more people now.
It passed the hat. No.
Now
it's
your turn.
Listen.
Have an acoustic. Great. Go ahead, Jack. Okay, you go. Sing. Come on.
No,
Neely. Come on, Jen. Come on, Jen. We beat us.
What?